So officially allow me to say good morning. What an honor, what a privilege it is to be here with you. I'm so grateful for the opportunity to share in this Sabbath morning with you. Thank you so much for the amazing welcome, the hospitality that all of you have shown. All of the All Souls staff have certainly made me feel welcome. I've been a member of the greater Tulsa community for only a year and a couple of weeks now. It's moments like this morning which affirm in me why I chose to move my family to this place that I never thought I would live. I jokingly say, if you had asked me 3-4 years ago, oh, you want to move to Tulsa? Better yet, you want to move to Oklahoma? It's not that bad. I like it here. Now, we are very happy to be a part of the Tulsa community and to be here. And as I am now beginning my second year as a Tulsan, thank you all once again for such a warm and hospitable welcome. So now I've had time to reflect. 1 year in the cycle of the calendar, 1 year of the seasons. By the way, who said it's okay to be this hot? And what was that stuff that happened in May? No one told me about tornadoes. That being said, summer is an interesting time for transitions. In my world, it signifies the ending and the beginning of the fiscal year at our Temple Israel, with budgets, board terms, and everything that flows with that. And summer signifies the coming of the beginning of a new religious school year, which I already have in my head, August 25th, it's coming. And my son, who we mentioned earlier, he's the geeky, weird kid. I say this lovingly. Before you mentioned he loves trains, he has been away for the last few weeks at science camp. Yeah, which has been great for him. And when he returns, he will soon begin a new school year at Jenks High School as a rising freshman. Summer is the time for new jobs, new opportunities. We can call this the beginning of a new year for many of us. So this morning, my friends, as we continue to get to know one another, I wish to share with you some news about my health. I've known for several years now of this issue. I have a somewhat common yet uncontained illness. And as we begin this relationship in this year anew, it's important to me that you know about my recently confirmed diagnosis. It's been confirmed by experts. Just ask my wife. I have the disease of being busy. This is a really nasty, nasty disease, which is contagious. And let's call it what it is, the dis-ease of being busy. When we're never at ease, it's never enough. It spreads like a virus. This disease has been time-consuming, overwhelming, exhausting, often leaving me overextended. It has impacted every aspect of my life, leaving no part of my daily routine untouched. This disease is spiritually destructive to our health and well-being. It zaps our ability to be fully present with those we love the most and keeps us from forming the kind of community that we all so desperately desire and need. I've recently read multiple articles about this disease and heard many NPR pieces on this issue. Many people believe that the epidemic of disease began in 2009, give or take, with the advance of the smartphone. I could sit down now. We've had many new technological innovations in the past decade, which promised would make our lives easier, faster, and simpler. Members of our society were awestruck, amazed to have a computer in one's pocket. The internet literally at our fingertips. Just ask Google, ask Siri, ask Alexa, any one of our friends. I'm not so certain our lives are any easier or simpler, faster. Yes, easier. The disease has changed our individual needs. We've become a society of instant gratification. We need it, whatever it is, now. For some of us, the lines between work and home have been blurred. Smartphones and laptops mean there is no division from the walls of the office and the rest of our lives. I recently read that the average person should conceivably be checking their phone 6 to 8 times a day. Okay. Not taking into account the actual email, text, social network notifications, which push their way to notification on your device. Sociologists, big word, have discovered the average person in reality is not checking their phone 6 to 8 times a day, but over 100 times a day. The average person spends 2 to 3 hours each day connected to their smartphone. The average person is not present 2 to 3 hours a day because of their connectedness to their smartphone. That's the equivalent to over 1 month each year. One of the ways that this insidious 21st century disease manifests itself is that we feel the need to be busy all of the time. In essence, we feel the need to fill up our days and fill up our calendars. If any of you are like me, you check your calendar in the evening before bed so you're able to plan for the day to come. We start out with the annual holiday calendar, that's input. Add the national holidays to it. We add the school calendar and the vacation calendar. There is soccer practice, dance recitals, tutoring, school plays. There are volunteer board meetings and fundraising events. Our calendars are full before the day even begins. We even put the weekly shopping, chores, and domestic demands on our calendars and on our schedules, many of which we can call upon Alexa to help us with. The calendar has also caused an increased level of anxiety. It's induced another symptom of this disease, FOMO, fear of missing out. Additionally, we've all had one of those fated mornings when we have that calendar laid out and we've got division and we've got the direction, and then the washing machine hose bursts. Water is flooding your kitchen, turning your world upside down. Or how about those moments when you were 15 minutes before a deadline and that someone, you know that someone, approaches you with the, "I'm terribly sorry to interrupt you. This will only take a minute." Are they really sorry to be interrupting you? And tell me, does it ever really take just a minute? I've heard people talk about games or quips to try to offer treatment to this disease. I once attended a dinner with a group of colleagues, 10 rabbis around a table. It's not a joke. We were at a dinner, and we all agreed to put our phones in the center of the table for the duration of the meal in order to be present for one another. The first person to touch their phone was to buy dinner for the group. Let's just say this was a failed treatment attempt. In other words, this is just a small bandage on a major hemorrhage. I've heard others talk about leaving your device in your pocket or bag throughout the whole commute to work. Don't check your email at stoplights or even listen to a podcast on the bus. Be present in the moment. Talk to the person next to you. Again, only a treatment to the symptoms. It's not a cure. Try to remember, you're a human being, not a human doing. Should I repeat that? You're a human being, not a human doing. Try to remember that you are more than just a machine checking off items on your to-do list. Have that conversation. Have that glance. Have that personal touch. Be in a healing conversation, one filled with presence. Put your hand on my arm. Look me in the eye. Connect with me for 1 second in the day. Tell me something from your heart. Awaken my soul. Help me remember that I too am full and complete as a human being. A human being who also craves a human touch, not a text, not an email. There's good news about this disease of being busy, and there is a cure. Not long ago, I attended a seminar designed for church leaders who aspire to develop stronger leadership teams. Again, something they don't teach you in seminary. This is where I discovered the cure to my ailment. One of the speakers at this seminar was a woman by the name of Juliette Funt. Coincidentally, you might recognize the name. She is the daughter of Alan Funt. Oh, there is not a camera, just so you know. Alan Funt of Candid Camera fame. This is his daughter, and she created this premise she calls WhiteSpace at Work. Funt argues WhiteSpace is a strategic pause taken between activities. It can be used in tiny sips as small as 2 seconds or in longer stretches. These thoughtful pauses, laced throughout the busyness of the day, are the oxygen that allows everything else to catch fire. White space can be recuperative, to reboot your exhausted brain, your body, and I add, your soul. As I sat listening during this seminar, I was sitting with two other rabbis, and we were texting with a half dozen other colleagues who were in the same streamed lecture in different cities. Of course, now I'm using the technology that I'm arguing against. You were thinking that, weren't you? So we're all sitting here texting and chatting with one another during this seminar, trying to conceive where Torah, where our own Jewish teaching presents white space. The irony of this moment, as I said, was not missed. We began to lean into one another, excitedly texting and whispering, Shabbat, the Sabbath, it's white space. You see, Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel, who's a 20th century theologian and a human rights activist, actually, he was one of the rabbis marching with Dr. King many years ago. He spoke of Shabbat as a day for the sake of life. Man is not a beast of burden, and the Sabbath is not for the purpose of enhancing the efficacy of his work. Last in creation, first in intention. The Sabbath is the end of the creation of heaven and earth. Heschel saw Shabbat, the Sabbath, as the completion of creation. And he later goes on to state, the meaning of the Sabbath is to celebrate time rather than space. 6 days a week we live under the tyranny of things of space. On the Sabbath we try to become attuned to the holiness in time. It's a day on which we are called upon to share in what is eternal in time. To turn from the results of creation to the mystery of creation, from the world of creation to the creation of the world. Heschel explains that the Sabbath is all holiness, for the Sabbath maintains all souls. A medieval sage declares, the world which was created in 6 days was a world without a soul. It was on the seventh day that the world was given a soul. The Sabbath, or I'll add, the sabbatical of white space. The space we create within our own time is intentional and as it rejuvenates the soul. As I sat there on that afternoon with my colleagues rediscovering white space, I thought to myself, we're lucky as Jews. We are innately given a white space built into our tradition. Instantly, I was reminded of the famous idiom penned by the secular Israeli author of the 20th century, Echad Ha'am, who wrote, more than the Jews kept Shabbat, Shabbat has kept the Jewish people. Shabbat has kept the Jewish people, I think to myself. I'm also going to say, we're kidding ourselves. I'm an observant Jew. I attend services regularly, and I could even argue you all are observant in your faith, attending services regularly. I study Torah. I study the Bible. I look at the world through a specific ethical lens taught to me by my tradition, relishing in the opportunities to do what we call a mitzvah, a good deed. I also admit that I struggle with creating the white space of Shabbat. You see, I ruined my tradition for myself by becoming a professional Jew. All of those things that I fell in love with and said, I want to do that, now I'm too busy working to have the time to do that. I carry the deepest admiration, no, the deepest jealousy for those who keep what's called Shomer Shabbat. In the traditional sense of the term, Shomer meaning to guard, protect, or keep, and Shabbat is the Sabbath. Those who refrain from work or from most anything for that matter. Imagine absolutely unplugging, checking out, and creating that white space in our minds, in our lives, in our hearts, and in our souls every Sabbath day. 24 hours. Rabbi Lawrence Kushner defines the concept in rabbinic literature known as midrash, as literature that appears in the spaces in between. So midrash is a compilation of stories, responses, questions written by the early rabbis to all of those questions that we get as individuals when we read Bible, when we read stories of the Bible. There's always those questions, well, why did they do such and such, and how did they get from there to there? And those questions that we don't have written answers for, the rabbis wrote them down in midrash. The literature that appears in the spaces in between. You see, I understand midrash to be the stories in between the letters. When we take a break in our lives from the black space, the letters, the programmatic, the imposed, we fill in the white space with meaning, helping us to discern and understand. Kushner wrote, "We open our eyes to the personality before us and see it as a new creation, as if it were born just that moment." We're missing precisely what Kushner taught. Open our eyes to see the personality before us, to see it as a new creation. Somehow we have allowed our world to become binary, existing only in ones and zeros, positives and negatives. All of these conveniences become a boundary and a hindrance to real life relationships. They stand in the way of productivity, creativity, growth, sincerity, and love. Creating white space in our lives enables us to remove those distractions. We each have our own distractions, those things which hinder our growth. Sometimes they're excuses, sometimes they just are. After all, as living, thinking beings, we're charged to continue growing throughout our lives. Sir Isaac Newton, or those of you that remember high school, remember Newton's law? I have to look at it because I don't remember. Objects in motion tend to stay in motion unless acted upon by another force. Did I get that right-ish? Okay. It becomes difficult to move forward if we have something holding us back. Earlier, I mentioned the smartphone, the email, and the busyness of life. What if that force acting upon us is not the external things, but the internal, our emotional baggage? I used to joke that some people have a backpack, others have a carry-on, and others have a full trunk of that emotional baggage. An internal force, whatever our baggage, impedes our growth. Picture your car. You get in the seat, you buckle your seatbelt. I was going to go like this, but you start your engine. And before you, what do you see? First of all, you see a large windshield. That's the future before you. That's where you are going. Then in the top center, you see this little rectangular thing, right? The rear view mirror, that's your past. That's where you've been. We begin to see things more clearly as we look out this big windshield. And we have the rear view mirror to remind us of where we've been, to remind us we store the baggage in the trunk behind us. In front of us, the wide open space as far as the eye can see. Once we eliminate the obstacles in our life, we begin to see things more clearly, gain perspective, and have vision. With that clear open road ahead of us, we have the white space with which to reflect. Upon reflection, we're able to see our own authenticity come through. I have a friend who I often call upon, somebody very active in the community. And whenever I ask for help, his response is simple. One simple word, hineni. It's a Hebrew term. Comes out of Torah, out of the Bible. I'll frame it to you this way. In the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve are in their nakedness, they've already eaten from the fruit, the apple, whatever we, however we want to translate it. They have their own personal awareness. And God calls out to Adam, Echa, where are you? This is not a physical placement, where are you, as much as a spiritual awareness, where are you in your life? And how does Adam respond? Hineni, here I am. But it's not here I am as in this spot. Here I am as in I'm open. I'm present to do your bidding. Later in Genesis, the story of the binding of Isaac. I love this story. Abraham is standing there. He has, I'll call it, duped his son into laying out on the altar because he's showing undying love to God, right? And there is Abraham with the knife getting ready to. That's the sound it makes. It's a translation. What happens in that moment? If you remember, the angel of God comes down and says, Avraham, Avraham, Abraham, Abraham. And he says, Hineni, I am ready, I am open, I am present. And that's when the angel goes on and says, do not lay a hand on that lad. We know you are God-fearing. So back to my story here. I have this friend who, whenever I call upon him to do anything, his response is simple. Hineni, I'm present to do your bidding. This is the authenticity of which I speak. Being fully present in one's life. Being fully present in one's work. Being fully present for one's family, friends, community, and being fully present in relationship not only with one another, but with God. Are you authentically present with your goals? Are you intentional in your life? How many of you, let's take a little poll, show of hands, who remembers the Automobile Club AAA? That's not the question. The product they had called the Triptych. This was before GPS, remember? You would go to AAA, to the storefront bricks and mortar location, and you'd share with them your destination, your goal. They would create for you this fancy little booklet in a plastic binding, remember? Painstakingly stamping in construction zones, detours, page by page. And I never knew how they knew where the construction zones were. They were like, bam, 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 bam. Like, how do you know there's... Anyway, they would provide you turn-by-turn instructions toward your goal. Painstaking, yet precise. And it was intentional. And it required prior, proper planning, preparation. Today in our binary world, my smartphone has GPS. I just tell it where I want to go and I trust that it's going to take me there, right? Better yet, I'm a big fan of the GPS app called Waze because it's participatory. There's a pothole. Ooh, tell somebody. There's a traffic jam. Tell somebody. Ooh, a cop. Tell somebody. And it often has us charging forward with no clear vision in mind, only a destination. We remove the distraction and become authentically present. By doing so, we alleviate fear, anger, and external stressors. We create those sabbatical moments, the moments of holiness and expression in the midst of our daily routine. Our daily routine moves to that of a sacred ritual. The holiness in our lives. We then move to a place of blessings. And in Judaism, we're taught to count our blessings, 100 blessings a day. By living with intentional means, authentically, with purpose, we begin to identify blessings in our lives. And I believe that white space can become the blessings in our moments. We can create white space. We begin to live with sacred purpose. Our actions and our relationships become those blessings. How many of you get up in the morning and have breakfast as a family? Okay, show of hands. Okay. What does that look like? I mean, what does it really look like? I can imagine one person is pouring cereal and making toast. Another is packing lunches if you've got children. Someone else is already on their phone texting or posting a picture on social media, you know, of the bowl of cereal that they're eating. And then somewhere in the background, you hear, "Mom, I can't find my purple sweater. Has anyone seen the car keys?" You've heard that one, haven't you? Now imagine a life of intention and blessing. That breakfast routine becomes a sacred ritual. The holiness of God is in our midst across the table. Conscious time is spent around the table, engaging in the personalities before us, attuned to the sacred time together. How different our days would look and feel if we were to create that ritual space in our lives. What if we acknowledged that breakfast time is a blessing, a gift from the Holy One? What if we acknowledge one another around the table as blessings, as a gift from the Holy One? White space is the blessings in our lives by treating the blessings as sabbatical moments in time as well as space. We create an intentional sacredness in our lives. During these summer months, the All Souls community has been engaging in a teaching theme of trading places. As you've gathered, the trading of places may be that of physical places. You've got a rabbi before you tonight, today. What time is it? By placing tension on our lives, practices, rituals, we move to a place of intentional sacredness. Not only are we trading places physically, we take the time to find the means and methods to cure ourselves of the disease of being busy, trading spaces spiritually. As we make our way into these transitional summer months, may each of you find meaning in the white space of your lives. May you spend purposeful time with your loved ones, God willing. May you spend reflective time with your being. And may this coming year find you in completeness through those sabbatical white space moments in your lives. May this be our lesson, our blessing. May this be our cause. Good morning, and thank you so much for allowing me to be here.
so happy you're visiting with us online today. We love connecting with people all across the country and around the world, sharing our powerful message of love beyond belief.
There's something new happening here. You can now join All Souls as a virtual member. Our virtual membership is designed for friends who live outside of Tulsa, Oklahoma, and who want to engage with All Souls in a meaningful way.
You can be part of an expanding family, a global family, really, wherever you are. If you live in Oklahoma,
Ohio,
or Orange County, California,
Canada,
or Cameroon, by becoming a virtual member, you'll be able to deepen your connections with members and friends here in Tulsa and with members wherever you are.
Each week, you'll receive special All Souls content tailored for you, our virtual members. Virtual members have access to pastoral care, to personal prayers, and also receive invitations to exclusive web events.
You can learn more, and if you're ready, you can become a virtual member today by visiting allsoulschurch.org/virtual membership.
We're grateful our ministries are having a positive impact on your life, and we want to share the good news of love beyond belief with more and more people. So no matter what, we need your support to keep this ministry growing and thriving. So please consider making a gift today. You can do so by texting
LoveBB for Love Beyond Belief to 73256, or simply visit our website. You are a blessing in our lives. May you be blessed.
And be a blessing.